Hello everyone, my name is Rachel and welcome back to my channel. So the case that I have for you guys today is a more recent case and it is a little bit of a shorter case, but I feel like this case is so important to get out there and her story is so important to talk about. It's yet another case of a woman being stalked and the outcomes being the absolute worst possible scenario because it just seems like nobody took it seriously enough. But before we get into the video, I just wanted to go ahead and say a huge thank you to today's sponsor, Albert. I'm actually really excited to be partnering with Albert because I've been using them for quite some time before they reached out to me to partner with me on a video. I really like Albert because they're a way to save money without relying on a traditional bank account. And honestly, I am fed up with traditional banks. They charge you a $35 plus overdraft fee, which has happened to me so many times, more times than I would like to admit, and every single time, it's so frustrating. And a lot of times, bank will charge you literally for using their bank to store your money. Whether they make you keep a certain amount of money in your account at all times, or they charge you a monthly fee just for using their bank, or both, which has happened in my case, it's just so crazy to me that you have to pay them money to store your money and use your own money. Plus, if you have a savings account in a traditional bank, you have to remember every single paycheck to transfer over however much money you want into your savings account. Albert is completely different than any bank account that you have ever used. Albert actually helps you save money. You can sign up for free and it is so easy to sign up. And Albert helps you by looking at your income and your expenses to see how much money you can save. And then it automatically moves money into your savings account, sometimes only being a few dollars at a time. I've been using Albert for a while at this point, like I said, and you would be surprised with how much money that you can save in just a couple of months without even realizing it. I've been trying to save for some upcoming vacations and I was so surprised with how much money I have at this point without putting in any effort. But even beyond saving, you can get $250 whenever you need it, hitting your account within minutes with absolutely no overdraft fees. They'll spot you $250 by advancing it from your next paycheck, and then you pay it back to them with no interest and no credit check. When you download the app, you will find out exactly how much you qualify for. The other really cool feature that Albert has is Genius. If you're anything like me and maybe not the most financially responsible or, you know, knowledgeable about money, then managing money can really suck. But Albert has a team of financial experts that they call their geniuses who will look at your situation and then help you come up with a plan and then answer any questions for you whenever you get stuck. And I'm so excited about the offer that they have for my subscribers. If you open an account and connect a qualifying direct deposit, you can get $150. So make sure you click the link down in the description box below or head over to albert.com/RachelShannon today. That's albert.com/RachelShannon. For a limited time, if you open a checking account and connect a qualifying direct deposit, you'll get $150. Thank you again so much to Albert for sponsoring today's video. With that being said, let's get into today's case. Today, we are going to be discussing the case of Abigail Saldana. Abigail Saldana, who went by Abby, was born February 4th, 1999, in Wichita Falls, Texas, to her parents Jessica Contreras and Mario Saldana, and she was only 22 years old at the time of her death. She was described as being a very hard worker and a lover of music, makeup, fashion, and especially her family. She had a son named Joseph Day, who she absolutely adored. She was also known to have a contagious laugh and an uplifting personality. She was very independent and did her best to be the best mother that she absolutely could. Her mother still lives in Wichita Falls and said that Abby moved to the Dallas-Fort Worth area about 2 years prior to her death with her five-year-old son, Joseph. She had been working two jobs, one at a brow studio as a certified brow artist and another at Rick's Cabernet DFW as an exotic dancer. So about 2 weeks prior to her death, Abby took to Instagram to show a tracking device that she had found on her car. She was so freaked out by this, captioning the video, "Check under your car, ladies. This is no joke." She said, "This is why you have to be careful." She said that she doesn't know what to do moving forward with this, but it definitely looks like a tracker to her.
But this was literally on my car like this. This is why you have to be careful. I don't really know what to do moving forward with this, but this definitely looks like a tracker to me. All right. So this is so crazy, you guys. So crazy. Like, who would do this? It says sell.
Abby's mom reports that she did report this tracker to police, but as far as I've seen, I'm not sure if any action was actually taken. What we do know, though, is that Abby had expressed to her manager at Rick's Cabernet that she was being harassed by one of their patrons. Again, I don't know if anything was actually done about this, but I'm pretty sure nothing was. So by Tuesday, October 26th, 2021, 911 received a call from a witness who reported seeing a horrific accident on Highway 183 in Fort Worth. The caller described seeing a silver Hyundai sedan speeding off before driving off the International Parkway exit ramp and then going into a grassy area near the roadway. The caller said that they stopped to check on the driver and see if they were okay, but when they approached the car, they noticed that there were bullet holes through the window on the passenger side of the car. And they said that the driver of this car was not responsive. When police arrived on the scene, they were quickly able to determine that the driver of this car was in fact deceased. They were able to locate a passport within the car, and this identified the driver as being 22-year-old Abby Saldana. Upon inspection, they found that Abby had been shot in her right arm as well as the right side of her back. At the scene, police found three shell casings as well as broken glass near the intersection of Ammon Carter Boulevard and Texas 183, which was near where her car was found. Police also noted that there were clothes in her car which were consistent with something that an exotic dancer would wear. So where the crash happened was literally within view of Rick's Cabernet, so police went ahead and paid them a visit to see if she worked there, and as we know, she did. Police talked to the managers who did confirm that Abby worked there, but managers also told police about a customer of theirs named Stan who had recently been harassing Abby. They didn't exactly know who this man was, but what they did know was that he was a military veteran. They told police that Abby had been afraid because this man had been stalking and harassing her. They then showed police this video of Abby finding the tracker on her car. But the managers also did have Stan's Instagram accounts, which had several concerning posts. So he has a couple posts showing off that he's a Marine, but he also has several posts with inspirational quotes on them. On September 21st, 2021, he posted one that reads, "Humble means recognizing that we are not on Earth to see how important we can become, but to see how much difference we can make in the lives of others." Another one, posted on July 15th, says, "Don't wait until you've reached your goal to be proud of yourself. Be proud of every step you take towards reaching that goal." Then he had another post saying, "Do not get upset with people because of situations. Both are powerless without your reaction." This was posted on October 21st, which this post is my absolute favorite given the other information that we will find out about this case. But then we see other very concerning posts, which shows his growing obsession with Abby. On October 17th, 2021, he posted, "I never thought I'd be one of those guys to be taken advantage of. Sharing for awareness. Abigail S. and I, since July 2021, have been enjoying each other's company. She's so beautiful and personable that I envisioned a future with her. But dealing with all the lies is overwhelming. I realize that's part of your primary job as an adult entertainer. But leave it at the club. If you only leave your second job being in a high-end prostitution ring, we could move forward. Yes, this pays $2,000 per session, but it's illegal. And having a boyfriend while having sex with other men?" And then with this post, he had the caption, "Folks always verify that the receipt given to you at a club or bar is correct. Mine was incorrect. I still signed." Then on his account, he has screenshots of other posts, basically to highlight and emphasize things that Abby had liked on her own personal account. Again, I want to emphasize that these are not things that Abby had posted herself, literally just things that she had double-tapped and liked. So on October 20th, Abby had liked a post that read, "I need an N-word that's gonna choose me over his family, 'cause blood ain't thicker than this fat P-word." And then Stan captioned this, "Damn Abby, I thought it was always family first." The next screenshot of a post that Abby had liked reads, "An N-word gun worship the ground I walk on or get the F out of my face. Simple." And then he put the caption, "Ouch." The next screenshot of something that Abby liked said, "And if you're riding with me this summer, make sure you single. I'm not turning down the music because yo N-word trying to see where you at." And then he had no caption with this. The last screenshot he posted said, "And I'm not getting on top if I got a bounce on a pacifier." Again, these are all things that Abby had liked on her personal account, all things that Stan was watching. I guess these are things that he saw that she was liking, and they made him upset because he took them very personally. All of these posts of these screenshots were made on October 20th. Then he posted a picture on October 24th of Abby with a caption saying, "Nice rack." So all of these posts were made on one Instagram account. So clearly he has this weird obsession with her. He's taking a bunch of things personally that make absolutely no sense. Maybe she was thinking about him when she liked these posts, and he's just so insecure that they made him that upset. I don't really know. But he has another account where he made more posts and more screenshots, which basically insinuating that he had paid Abby several thousands of dollars to sleep with him. So first, on October 17th, he made a post saying, "All the payments to Abigail and RCI were for sex-related activities. My Chase account has many more transactions." Then another post on the same day shows several Zelle payments to Abby with amounts of $1,000, then $200, then $800. There are also two withdrawals from an ATM for $500 each. More posts from October 21st shows more screenshots of messages between him and Abby. They read, "I never liked you. You're a trick to everyone. Leave me alone. If you're not going to pay me, then we have nothing to talk about. So I don't care what you post about me. If you want to come back to Rick's, then I will have to talk to the managers for you. But you have to bring $3,000 for me." To which he replied, "You just admitted to being a prostitute. Any man who lets women use him for his wallet. It comes from the term prostitutes used to describe the men who pay them for sex." He screenshotted this with the caption, "A woman that can't be bought isn't worth having." On October 21st, he made another post with screenshots of messages between him and Abby. It reads, "Made it, babe. Tonight was amazing. I wish I could have stayed." He replied, "Glad you're home safe. You're amazing." She said, "Likewise, babe. I hope I can see you next Friday." He said, "You can." She said, "Did I leave my key fob there?" He said, "Let me check." She then described the key fob before texting again saying, "Found a babe. LOL, so sorry, but thank you. I had a good time and I definitely can't wait to see you again," with a kiss emoji. He replied, "Yeah, see you again ASAP. Be safe." Then he said, "I could seriously spend hours between your legs. You are so perfect, both personality and physically." She replied, "Baby, you are unbelievable. You had me going crazy." In the same post, he shows other screenshots of multiple Zelle payments looking like he paid other women, then multiple ATM withdrawals. Then there's another screenshot of him paying her via Apple Pay. It shows on July 28th, he paid her $2,000 and then another $1,000. Another screenshot shows a payment to her of $4,000 on August 15th. So from all these posts, we can tell that Stan was paying Abby to sleep with him and was also paying multiple other women. Clearly, she was playing along with this, making him feel good and making him feel like she was actually interested in him, not that she was just, you know, sleeping with him for the money. But clearly, she had him fooled. He was still paying her, but he, for some reason, was still, you know, believing this assumption that she actually liked him. But then he saw the other posts that she was liking and he got upset. Clearly, he realized that she was only using him for the money, which again should have been completely obvious, but for whatever reason, he just didn't get it. And this man, who is clearly very insecure, clearly has very little self-worth, and clearly does not think very highly of himself, got jealous at the fact that he had to pay this woman for having sex with him, that she wasn't actually enjoying his company, that she didn't actually find him attractive at all. Then, even though he was clearly doing the same thing with other women, clearly paying other women to sleep with him, he latched on Abby and became absolutely obsessed with her. It looked like he literally just couldn't handle the fact that she never really liked him, and his insecurities, whatever he had going on, just got to him and he wanted to take it out on someone else. Police were also able to take a look at Abby's phone, which showed that she actually knew that she was being followed. Obviously, we know what she posted about her finding that tracker on her car. But in addition to that, she had actually figured out the car that was following her and then took a picture of the car and the license plate and sent that picture to a friend. Using this along with the Instagram posts and then using the things that the managers at Rick's Cabernet had said about him, police identified this man as 53-year-old Stanley Salija. Using the photo of the license plate that Abby had sent to another friend, police were also able to connect these license plates to Stanley. They used that to search a license plate reader, which picked up Stanley's Ford F-150 pickup truck traveling near Abby's home in Farmers Branch at least 5 times over a 12-day span, which indicated that he had been stalking her. They then saw that his car was in close proximity to Abby's house just 17 minutes before her shooting was reported. Then on the same day that she was murdered, Abby's car was picked up on cameras at the intersection of Midway Road and McEwen Road, about 17 miles away from where Abby would later be found shot. Then, just seconds after Abby's car was seen there, Stanley's car was also captured. So obviously this indicated that Stanley was following Abby that day. So by October 27th, 2021, police reached out to Stanley and asked him to do an interview with them. But then, 15 minutes before the scheduled appointment, he called police to tell them that he could no longer do this interview because he had a death in his family. So police went ahead and obtained a search warrant for Stanley's home at the Los Colinas apartments. When police arrived, however, Stanley refused to come out of his residence, so they sent in a SWAT team who entered his apartment, and he was actually found on his balcony with a bunch of wounds all over his face, which appeared to be self-inflicted. And these wounds were pretty superficial in nature. He was taken to the hospital shortly after, and he was immediately charged in connection with Abby's death. And as far as I've seen, that's pretty much where the case stands. He's currently being held at the Lons Evans Correction Center on a $250,000 bond. So that's pretty much all the information that I have on Abby's case. Clearly, we can see that Stanley was the one who put this tracker on her car and then stalked her and killed her. Apparently because he was so upset that she was using him for his money, even though that's very clearly what he agreed to, that's clearly what was happening, she clearly was asking him for money, and for whatever reason, he just got this misconstrued idea in his head that she actually liked him for some reason. It's actually interesting, if you go to his Instagram, there's a bunch of comments on there of basically people like bullying him, making fun of him, or calling him a disgusting person, saying that, you know, she schmoozed you out of a bunch of money and now you're upset and you're acting like a child and you took someone's life because of it. This is such a terrifying case. Obviously, I'm sitting here kind of making jokes about how, you know, insecure he was and, you know, how pathetic he is and how disgusting he is. But this stuff really happens clearly, as we can see. It's just very disturbing that someone can get this obsession with someone and then suddenly they think that they're entitled to that person. They think that because, you know, you're sleeping with them and they're paying you, that suddenly you can't like certain Instagram posts, that you aren't allowed to talk to anybody else even though they're sleeping with many other women. They get this weird idea in their head that you belong to them, and it's very disturbing. It's very scary. And these things really happen in real life, and it's just really, really terrifying to think about, honestly. It's absolutely terrifying to me that she found this tracker on her car and then she literally reported it to police and then she was murdered shortly after. Like I said, I don't have any information on whether police took action or not or what action they took if they did. But overall, I just feel like police do not take cases of stalking seriously enough, and this is often what ends up happening. My heart absolutely goes out to her family and her son. She was just trying her best to provide for him, even if it was with sex work. Again, I don't want to hear any negative comments about what she was doing. Everyone around her knew how much she truly cared about her son, and she just wanted to do what was best for him. So again, I completely understand that a lot of people do not agree with Abby's lifestyle. A lot of people don't agree with the way she chose to make money. I get that. I get that that is a risky lifestyle to be involved in. I'm just gonna say it how it is. This is a risky thing to be involved in. Whether you are involved in it or you're thinking of it, this is very risky, and this is something that can put your life in danger, and it's not something that I want anybody to have to go through. So for the sake of people saying that, you know, I didn't give too much credit for, you know, the risky parts of her lifestyle, there's me saying that. But she was so young. She was just trying to find her way in life, and she did not deserve her life to be taken away from her just because somebody was obsessed with her. So again, let's respect the victim. The only person responsible for Abby's murder is her murderer, Stanley. But either way, that is where I'm going to end today's video. If you liked this video, please make sure to go ahead and leave this video a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. I put out new true crime and mystery videos every single week. Don't forget to go ahead and turn the notification bell to on so you don't miss out on any of my future videos. Make sure to go ahead and follow my Twitter and Instagram. Both will be linked down below. And if you have absolutely any case suggestions, please make sure to send those suggestions over to my email at RachelShannonCases@gmail.com. With that, I hope you guys have a great week. Stay safe, stay healthy, and I hope to see you next time. Bye!